Dynamic programming is a very interesting and powerful algorithm optimization technique, and in this video, to better understand how is DP used to optimize solutions, we will see two classic dynamic programming problems, the Fibonacci sequence problem and the minimum cost path problem. Let's start with the first one. We have the mathematical definition of the Fibonacci sequence, and we want to calculate the value of the term n. We know that fib0 is 0, fib1 is 1, and fibn is the sum of its two previous terms, fib of n minus 1 and fib of n minus 2. So we can just write this recursive function to calculate fib of n. If n is 0, then the value is 0, else if n is 1, then the value is 1, else is the sum of fib of n minus 1 and fib of n minus 2. So we return fib of n minus 1 plus fib of n minus 2. This solution works, but the problem is that it's slow, really slow, because each call is calling the function twice in the recursive case, and we end up with an exponential time complexity. Let's see how we can optimize it by using dynamic programming. Dynamic programming says that we can optimize a recursive function by storing the results of already computed subproblems so that we don't have to do it again later. What does this sentence mean? It means that when we solve a problem by dividing it into smaller subproblems, it's possible that we solve the same subproblem many times uselessly. So it's better to store the result of each subproblem we solve, so that the next time we face the same subproblem, we don't do the work again, we just take the value from the structure where we stored it. Okay, but how can we apply this to Fibonacci? We calculated fib of n by calculating fib of n minus 1 and fib of n minus 2. What we did here is that we broke the problem into smaller subproblems. The initial problem was to calculate fib of n, and the smaller subproblems are to calculate fib of n minus 1 and fib of n minus 2. But to calculate fib of n minus 1, we also break it down into two subproblems, fib of n minus 2 and fib of n minus 3. And this process continues like that until we reach the smallest possible subproblems, which are fib0 and fib1, as we know the value. But if we take a look at the recursion tree, which is on the screen right now, we can notice that there are subproblems that we solved many times. We say that we have overlapping subproblems. And the fact that we're doing the same work over and over is slowing down the process. What can we do to avoid it? Here comes dynamic programming. With dynamic programming, once we calculate fib4 for example, we store the result somewhere so that the next time we need the value of fib4, we don't do all the work again, we just take the value we stored previously. And we have two approaches to do so. We have the top-down approach, memoization, where the function remains recursive but we add a lookup table to store the output before returning it, and the recursion tree becomes way smaller. As you can see in the code, the function has an extra parameter, the lookup table, and we added a base case to handle the case where we already computed the value before. So if we find n in the keys of our lookup table, we directly return lookup of n. We also modify the recursive case. Before returning the value, we store it in the lookup table. In this approach, we started by trying to calculate fib of n, for that we calculated fib of n minus 1 and fib of n minus 2, and so on until base cases. This is why it's called top-down approach. But we also have the bottom-up approach, by using tabulation. This one is usually done iteratively, not recursively. In this one, we do the opposite of the top-down approach. Here we start by solving the smallest subproblems, then we solve bigger and bigger subproblems until we reach the one we wanted to solve initially. All that by using some extra space to store intermediate results. In our example, we will use an array dp of n plus 1 elements, where dp of I represents the term I of the Fibonacci sequence. And we're searching for the term n, this is why we go until the index n, so the final result will be in the last cell of this array. Let's start. The smallest subproblems are the ones whose we know the value, fib0 and fib1 in our case, whose values are 0 and 1 respectively. So we put 0 in dp of 0 and 1 in dp of 1. Now to fill remaining cells, for each index I, we just do the sum of the two previous elements, because dp of I represents ui, and ui is u of I minus 1 plus u of I minus 2. So dp of I is equal to dp of I minus 1 plus dp of I minus 2. The value we're searching for is in the last cell, we return it. And both of these approaches give an O of n time complexity thanks to dynamic programming, which is way better than the exponential time complexity of the non-optimized recursive solution. Now we move to the second problem, but before we take some seconds to comment under this video, give me your feedback on it, and what videos do you want to see on this channel. The second problem that we will see is the minimum cost path in matrix problem. We have a matrix of size n by m where the value of a cell represents the cost of passing from it. And we want to calculate the minimum cost to go from the top left cell to the bottom right cell, knowing that we can only move to the right or to the bottom. The cost of a path is the sum of costs of all the cells it passes from. An intuitive approach to solve this problem is the greedy approach, to always choose the cheapest cell and go to it. But this method doesn't always give the right answer. Always choosing the cheapest cell doesn't guarantee getting the minimum cost path. So let's see another approach. When being on the top left cell, we don't know which move will lead us to the minimum cost path. Should we move to the right, to the bottom? We don't know. So the idea is to get the minimum cost when we start from the cell that is on the right, the minimum cost when we start from the cell that is on the bottom. We take the minimum among them, we add to it the cost of the actual cell, and we get the minimum cost. But to get those minimum costs, we also need to do the same thing, so we'll get a recursive function. Here we have two base cases. The first base case is when we are at the bottom right cell. The cost to go from the bottom right cell to the bottom right cell is the value of the bottom right cell itself, so we just return its value, without calling the function again. The second base case is when we go out of the matrix, we return infinity. It's not really a cost, but it means that we can't go to the bottom right cell from here, we are out of the matrix. And in the recursive case, we return the cost of the actual cell plus the minimum between the cost by going to the right, that we can get by calling the function with ig plus 1, and the cost by going to the bottom, that we can get by calling the function with I plus 1 g. Note that I and g are the coordinates of the actual cell. This solution works, but same as the recursive solution of the Fibonacci problem, at least the non-optimized one, it has an exponential time complexity. If we have a look at the recursion tree of this example, we can notice a lot of repeated recursive calls. We did use that we have overlapping subproblems, so we are doing the same work over and over uselessly. And here comes dynamic programming to fix this. Let's see how to optimize our solution with those two dynamic programming approaches. By using the top-down approach, we add a lookup table where the key is the couple ig that represents the coordinates of a cell in the matrix, and the value is the result we calculated, the minimum cost. And same as with Fibonacci, we add a base case to check if we didn't calculate the result before, and we store the output in the lookup table before returning it. And by using the bottom-up approach, we use a matrix dp of size n by m, where dp of ig represents the minimum cost of going from the top left cell to the cell that indexes ig. So when we finish filling the dp matrix, the bottom right cell will represent the minimum cost of going from the top left cell to the bottom right cell, we return it. And to fill the dp matrix, we start by the smallest possible subproblems. Here the smallest subproblem is calculating the cost of going from the top left cell to the top left cell, which is the cost of the top left cell itself. So we write dp of 0, 0 is equal to mat of 0, 0. And the logic we use for remaining cells is to get the minimum cost between coming from the top and coming from the left, because they are the only two cells that can go to the cell ig. We take the minimum between these two costs and we add to it the cost of the actual cell. And this concept of checking the values of cells that can go to the actual cell is very important to know. You will find it in a lot of dynamic programming solutions. So with this example, this is what happens. And as said earlier, the value we're searching for is in the bottom right cell, we return it. And these two approaches give us an O of n times m time complexity, which is way better than the exponential time complexity of the non-optimized recursive solution. We finished solving our two problems, and obviously, don't take this video as a crash course on dynamic programming. There are a lot of other things that you need to know about. Tell me if you want me to cover them in future videos. The last thing that I want to say in this video is that if you liked how I explained these two DP problems, I suggest you to take the 50 popular coding interview problems inside Code course. It contains 50 interesting and challenging coding problems that will grow your knowledge in algorithms and data structures. And some of these problems are related to dynamic programming, like the longest common subsequence problem, the 0-1 knapsack problem, the ways to climb stairs problem, and other ones. The link is in the description. We reached the end of this video. I hope that you now have a better understanding of why we use dynamic programming. Like and subscribe to the channel, and see you in the next one.